Okay, so a very good evening to all of you. This video is on pemphigoid in the diseases of the skin, where we're going to talk about what it is, what are its variants, cicatricial and bullous pemphigoid, etiology, clinical features, histopathology, immunofluorescence, and treatment. For more such videos, you can check out the channel To Be Told. So pemphigoid is nothing but a group of autoimmune blistering diseases which is characterized by sub-epidermal blisters and circulating antibodies against the basement membrane zone. So one, this is a group of autoimmune diseases. So there are cells of the body that attack one's own healthy cells. So it is an autoimmune disease. The second part is it is a blistering disease. So there is formation of vesicles and bullae. Vesicles and bullae are fluid-filled elevated lesions. If they're less than 0.5 centimeter, it is called a vesicle. If it is greater than 0.5 centimeter, it is called a bulla. So it is a group of autoimmune blistering diseases, which is characterized by sub-epidermal blister. So the blister occurs below the epithelium. This is the epithelium and this is the connective tissue. So the blister formation is below the epithelium. It is sub-epithelial. The fourth part tells us that it is caused by circulating antibodies against the basement membrane zone. It is against the basement membrane. Now, if you remember in the previous video, we have covered pemphigus where there is intradermal or vesicles within the epithelium and antibodies against the intercellular substance or the desmosomes. So again, this is a autoimmune blistering disease characterized by sub-epidermal blister and antibodies against the basement membrane zone. There are two clinical variants, which is the bullous pemphigoid and the cicatricial pemphigoid. The bullous pemphigoid mostly occurs on the skin, while cicatricial mostly occurs on the mucous membranes. Bullous pemphigoid has a limited course, whereas cicatricial is progressive in nature. So that is why let us start talking about the cicatricial. So the cicatricial pemphigoid is a disease that predominantly affects your mucous membranes. There are antibodies that are directed against the basement membrane. These are mainly IgG antibodies against the basement membrane proteins, which are BPAG2 and epiclearin. Okay, so here there is nothing but formation of IgG antibodies against the lamina densa. Okay, so this is your epithelium, this is your basement membrane, and this is your connective tissue. So there are antibodies against the basement membrane zone, right? There are structures present between the keratinocytes, which are called desmosomes, and they are present between the keratinocytes and basement membrane, which are called hemidesmosomes. So in this disease, the target is against hemidesmosomes, right, at the level of the lamina densa. Clinically, it appears in the age of 40 to 50, more in females. And the most common site of occurrence is the eyes and the oral mucosa, right? So here it is the eyes and the oral mucosa. Other surfaces are the pharynx, larynx, trachea, esophagus, vagina, urethra, and the anus. In the clinical presentation, initially what you have is a vesiculobullous eruption. So there is a vesicle or a bulla, there is a blister which heals by scar formation, right? The meaning of cicatrix is a scar. So that is why cicatricial pemphigoid indicates healing by scar. Now what happens is when there is something like this occurring in the eyes, in the ocular involvement, this will progressively lead to blindness. because adhesions develop between the palpebral and bulbar conjunctiva. So bulbar conjunctiva is the exposed conjunctiva and the palpebral is under the lid, right? So there is adhesion that develops between that, obliteration of your palpebral fissure, opacity of the cornea and progressive blindness. This is all a result of scar formation. In the oral mucosa, there is initially desquamative gingivitis. Okay, so these bullae and vesicles, they rupture. They lead to desquamative eroded areas. Persist 24 hours before desquamating, and once they rupture, they leave a raw eroded bleeding surface. Okay, so we have seen the ocular involvement, which led to blindness, and oral manifestation, which led to desquamative gingivitis. Histologically, the vesicles in bulla are subepidermal, right? This is the epithelium, this is the connective tissue, this is the basement membrane. The vesicles and bulla are subepidermal and there is no evidence of acantholysis. The epithelium is intact. The basement membrane appears to detach with the epithelium from the underlying connective tissue. So the epithelium, this is a more depth statement that the basement membrane appears to detach with the epithelium. Immunofluorescence studies demonstrate linear pattern of IgG fluorescence. Okay. In bullous pemphigoid, this is also this is the other variant. Okay, but this rarely involves your mucous membrane. Mainly involves the skin. There are IgG autoantibodies specific for hemidesmosomal bullous pemphigoid antigens. They activate complement and inflammatory mediators, which attract inflammatory cells, which release proteases and degrade the hemidesmosomal proteins, right? So here, there is autoantibodies specific to the hemidesmosomes, right? They activate complement and attract inflammatory cells, which degrade this hemidesmosomes. Clinically, it is 80% of the times above 60 years of age. There is no gender predilection. The most common site is the skin of the limbs and the abdomen. It starts as a non-specific rash on the limbs, which is urticarial or eczematous, right? So there is a rash, a pruritic rash, which occurs on the skin of the limbs and abdomen, which eventually develops into blisters, right? So first there is a rash which progresses into your blisters. These blisters are thick, walled and intact. In comparison to pemphigus, the pemphigus blisters were placid. In bullous pemphigoid, the blisters are thick, walled and intact and rupture after many days. Once they rupture, they leave a raw eroded area which heals rapidly. Oral manifestation is again extreme erythema and desquamative gingivitis. Histologically, again, the vesicle formation is subepithelial. The epithelium appears intact. The vesicle contains fibrinous exudate plus inflammatory cells. Multiple inflammatory cells and the basement membrane appears connected to the connective tissue, right? So the basement membrane appears connected to the connective tissue, and in here there is thickening of the interruption of the continuity. Immunofluorescence again, there is a linear band of immunofluorescence in the basement membrane zone, and the indirect immunofluorescence is also positive with circulating antibodies in 80%. The goal of the therapy is to decrease the blister and promote the healing. As well as in psychiatric pemphigoid, it is to prevent the scarring. What you use for this is systemic or topical thyroid. And as I've already told you, bullous pemphigoid is limited, whereas mucous membrane pemphigoid is progressive. In mucous membrane pemphigoid, there is associated complications of blindness, airway stenosis, esophageal stricture, and cutaneous blistering. And bullous is associated with long-term remission. Okay, so to conclude the video, let us talk about some differences between pemphigus vulgaris and pemphigoid, mainly bullous pemphigoid. Okay, so the most common age of occurrence for pemphigoid and pemphigus. So in pemphigus, it is middle-aged people, around 40 to 50 years, whereas in bullous pemphigoid, it is above the age of 60 years. Blisters are flaccid in pemphigus, whereas tense and firm in bullous. So in pemphigus, what happens is that the vesicle formation is intraepithelial, whereas in bullous, the vesicle formation is subepithelial, which is why here the bullae or the blisters, they are flaccid or they rupture easily, but in bullous, they are firm and tense. The next thing is the oral lesions are common in pemphigus vulgaris, right? 50 to 80% of the cases show oral lesions even before skin. But in bullous, they are rare. They are more common in mucous membrane pemphigoid. The Nikolsky sign is positive in pemphigus vulgaris, but negative in bullous pemphigoid. The Zank smear shows acantholysis in pemphigus, but no acantholysis in bullous pemphigoid. Why? Because in pemphigus vulgaris, we see that antibodies are against your desmosomes, right? So they are against the intracellular substance causing separation of cells, right? But in bullous pemphigoid, the antibodies are against the basement membrane zone. So they cause a split rather than acantholysis. So this is intact. The epithelium is intact. Direct immunofluorescence. So in direct immunofluorescence, you see intraepidermal deposits within the epithelium. These are intracellular. They give you a chicken wire or a fishnet fluorescence. But in bullous pemphigoid, the deposits are at the basement membrane zone. It is a linear deposition of IgG antibody. So with this, we come to the end of the video. A few review questions are, subepithelial split is a feature of, the answer is pemphigoid. And the second question is, descamative gingivitis may be seen in all of the following except, so the correct answer here is recurrent apthae, because it is seen in pemphigus vulgaris, it is seen in mucous membrane pemphigoid as we have just seen, it is also seen in lichen planus, which is the erythematous lichen planus, but it is not seen in recurrent apthae. A quick summary of whatever we have studied so far. We have studied what is pemphigoid. It is a group of autoimmune blistering diseases characterized by subepidermal blister and antibodies against the basement membrane zone. We have spoken on what is the vesicle of bulla, what are the clinical variants, which is bullous pemphigoid and psychiatricial pemphigoid. We have seen about psychiatricial pemphigoid, the main involvements being the oral mucosa and the eyes, leading to descamative gingivitis and progressive blindness. We have seen positive immunofluorescence as the linear band along the basement membrane zone. Then we have also seen bullous pemphigoid, which mainly involves the skin, in comparison to mucous membrane pemphigoid, which involved the mucous membrane. We've seen an age predilection. Then we have seen the course of the disease, which went from a rash to a blister to eroded areas. Then we saw the histology, where again there was a subepidermal blister with intact epithelium. But then we saw that the basement membrane remained attached to the connective tissue. In mucous membrane, it remained attached to the epithelium. The treatment, the main aim was to reduce the blisters and promote healing and prevent scars in mucous membrane pemphigoid. The course was progressive in mucous membrane pemphigoid, and the treatment involved steroids. Then we saw the differences between pemphigus vulgaris and bullous pemphigoid, which were mainly the type of the blisters being flaccid and firm, Nikolsky sign being positive and negative, Banks smear showing acantholysis and no acantholysis, and also the antigens targeted the desmosomes versus basement membrane proteins. So with this, I thank you for watching, and I hope you have a great day ahead and you benefit from this video. So bye.